I'm David Haussler, Scientific Director of the UC Santa Cruz Genomics Institute and a Howard Hughes Medical Institute investigator. It's my pleasure to be able to speak to you on great questions in biology. I want to have you imagine that you just got your genome sequenced. Now, when we sequenced the first genome in the year 2000, it cost about $300 million just for the sequencing reagents and activities, but nowadays it's a couple thousand bucks. So let's assume you went out and got your sequence done. Now, looking at that, it may be hard to interpret, but it's got to be a moving experience to look at that DNA sequence and think about how it got there. In particular, the DNA in your genome was passed on from generation to generation for eons. We all come out of the primordial ooze somewhere billions of years ago, and it's stunning to think that a record of many of those evolutionary events is still present in the genomes today. So what would you do? What would you look at to start to understand where you came from and what is specifically interesting about your genome versus all of the other genomes on the planet? Probably the first thing you would think about in terms of the way DNA is inherited from parents to offspring is, are there any new elements of your genome that weren't even in your parents? And the statistics say there will be a few. So there will be a few changes in the way that DNA was copied. You can think about them as errors, but you can also think about them as just fortuitous events that caused something different in your genome that wasn't in either of your parents' genomes. Those would be interesting, certainly, and they're probably only a very small handful of those. The next thing you would think about is there something that I inherited from my parents that's just specific to my family in some sense? Maybe it's something special that happened in a great-grandparent and has been passed down to me through all of these generations. Now, this is the very stuff of genetics to think about this. And in particular, in medical genetics, you would be very concerned if this actually made you prone to a disease. You might also be protected from a disease by a special version of a gene that's in your genome that's specific or private to your specific family. That would be exciting. And as we start to get from the era of just one genome in the year 2000, to the coming era of millions of genomes, we will be able to, by comparing genomes, understand what's specific to certain families, what's specific to certain ethnic groups, what's specific to humans in general, but not with other species. It's an enormous computational problem to compare all of these genomes, and this is probably the most significant challenge facing the computational part of genetics and genomics today. If you understood what was specific to humans, that would be fascinating. You could start to think about what happened since we diverged from our common ancestor with our closest species, the Neanderthal. While the Neanderthal are extinct, we were able to sequence DNA from their bones and hence get an idea of what their genomes looked like. And we find that there are more than a million changes that occurred in the human lineage since we diverged from our common ancestor to Neanderthal. So what an exciting project at this point to try to understand those changes that almost everybody, almost all of humankind, share as opposed to and distinguish them from the Neanderthal. Going back further, about 5 to 6 million years ago, we shared a common ancestor with the chimpanzee. Since that time, there have been roughly 15 million changes in our genome. which ones actually account for the difference between a human and a chimp? This is a substantial difference, and remarkably, we still know very little about which of those changes actually make that huge difference between a human and a chimp. One thing you'll run into in this quest is the fact that most of these changes are probably not important in some sense. If you look at the structure of your DNA, and in particular, if you look at it from this perspective of going back and looking at where the DNA came from, what its history is, you see that there are some parts of your genome that are shared with virtually all other life on the planet. The genes and the DNA and the genes in the ribosome sequences, DNA polymerase, other fundamental molecules that make life itself possible are remarkably little changed over the eons of evolutionary time. And so when you look at one of those bases in your genome, you can sit back and say, wow, that's a really ancient base. That base of DNA was passed on to me all the way back from the beginning, billions of years copied faithfully again and again and again. And now it is a gift to me so that my cells work. In between that are all stages of evolutionary innovation. So when you look at your genome, you'll find genes that were created essentially as an evolutionary process in the bilaterian animals, for example. The set of animals that have bilateral symmetry. This is a huge collection of animals on the planet, but they didn't exist 2 billion years ago. So all of their genetic innovations happened after that period. If you look at vertebrates, animals with a backbone, they didn't exist 800 million years ago. But now we can find all of the different innovations that are specific to the vertebrates, the backbone animals, and don't exist in other animals. And each one of these beautiful genetic innovations happened at a particular time in the marvelous history of life. So when you're looking at every gene in your genome, you can say, aha, that's a bilaterian innovation. Oh, and this one was invented by vertebrates. And maybe this one was invented by primates. And maybe this one is specific to apes. Understanding this is probably the greatest challenge to genomics going forward at this point. And we have an extraordinary opportunity to look at every base in the genome for the first time, and more importantly, to compare it to the bases in other genomes. The lesson we've learned from first sequencing the human genome in the year 2000, and then subsequently looking at the first chimpanzee genome, the first mouse genome, the first rat genome, the first dog genome, is that no genome is ever understandable in isolation. Every time we sequence the genome of a new species, we learned more about the genomes that we had previously sequenced from other species. And that is precisely because we share a common heritage and because we are sculpted by evolution. By looking at these patterns of conservation and change within our genome, we can often decode something about the function of a region of DNA. For example, if it codes for protein sequence, then it has to have this triplet pattern of codons. And you'll find that while there are changes in the region, they preserve this fundamental property of being able to code for protein. And we can see that clearly in the pattern of changes, which are allowed or not allowed. So that gives us a window just by studying comparisons between many pieces of DNA into the function of those pieces of DNA. But we're only seeing the tip of the iceberg here. We're very much at the beginning of a long journey now that we're in the genomics era and being able to look at all of these genomes together of decoding them through their history, through comparison. I hope you will consider taking this journey with us. It's a journey that needs not only biologists, but computer scientists. Right now, the world is struggling to be able to write the software code and create the computer architecture to be able to compare the full genomes from hundreds or thousands of different species. This is at the very edge of our capabilities at this point, and we can look forward to great innovations, both in terms of computers and algorithms, big data, cloud computing. All of these things will have a say, along with traditional fields like biology, molecular biology, biochemistry, and evolutionary population genetics. So it's a great time to be involved in this, and I invite you to this wonderful adventure.